Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. I've already preached a different message to you, but this is good stuff here. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. These verses are so pivotal in the Christian walk. If you think about it, America loves winners. We don't enjoy losers, boy. We like a winner. We like a winner team. That's why all of you love Alabama and Auburn. See, because they're winners. If you have four losing seasons, I don't care which guy, which coach, but at those two schools, if you had four losing seasons, maybe two, you'd get canned as the coach, because you folks expect a winner, and America loves winners. Think about our Olympic stars that we love. Michael Phelps had all kinds of problems, but he came back, and he's been one of the most, if not the heaviest, decorated gold athlete of the Summer Games ever. Michael Phelps knows how to win, and people will forgive someone for their sins and trespasses when they're a winner. And then there was Nadia Comaneci. Remember her back from the USSR back in the day? Oh man, that girl knew how to win. She scored a perfect 10 back in the day that they didn't award the 10s. And then you got Bruce Jenner. Bruce Jenner in the decathlon. Remember Bruce Jenner? Caitlin? That's a whole nother sermon. But the world has gone upside down, hasn't it? It's just crazy what we're living in, and yet you can be a winner in the eyes of Christ, and boy, that is important. If you finish strong, but how do you finish strong? Some of you are so focused on what's going on in the middle of your race, and you're quitting because you're looking at your track record, and you're saying, but look at my past. Look at the history. I've not done so well, and so you've given up. Or you're not giving your best because of your past. Or you're not where you need to be in the present. You can't microwave your faith and your spirituality. So you've got to listen closely today to these verses and the simple truth. I believe Paul's the author, but a lot of people have someone else writing this. But the author of Hebrews, he wrote some things in here that you and I should take and take home with us today and place in our hearts today and really apply to our lives. Three keys to become a winner and how not to sweat the small stuff. First, forsake your circumstances. He said there, let us lay aside every weight. Let us lay aside every weight. Can you imagine an Olympic swimmer like Michael Phelps getting into the pool to race the 200 meter with a full sweatsuit on? Well, of course he would. That's why swimmers take off their sweatsuit. And they either have a bodysuit on or just a skimpy little bathing suit. Back in the Panhellenic Games or the Isthmian Games, a runner would strip all the way down, and run, letting all the weight come off them. Can you imagine any Olympic runner with weights on their wrist and their ankles? No, they practice with such, but they don't run in the games with such. They take aside every weight and they lay them aside. They put them down. Why? Well, because they don't want to be encumbered by the weight of the past. You practice with extra weight and then you run in the game or the games with no weight because you want to be a winner. Turn to the person next to you and say, you want to be a winner. The writer and author here says, laying aside, which means casting off or putting away. It's putting it down and not picking it up again. Then he said, every weight, which means burden or hindrance. A Christian running the race of life with burdens and weights is a Christian that's allowing hindrances and problems to burden them and break them and break their body and their spirit down and make you feel as though you're a loser and not a winner, and Christ has declared you more than a conqueror through himself. So we want to run the race of life and not be encumbered by the weights of our past circumstances. Forsake them. Look with me at Hebrews chapter 5, verses 12 through 14. The author here is writing some folks, and he's talking to them about being children or adults in the faith and maturing in their walk with God. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God. In other words, the basics, because you've gotten away from them. And you have come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is like a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are full of age, that is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. I always wonder when someone, a sheep, goes wandering and people start saying, oh, Steve has wandered from the faith and we need to go and reprove him and bring him back. The Bible does say, the author says, those who are spiritual should go to that person and reprove them and bring them back. Well, I've learned in this present age, there's not a lot of people who don't think themselves to be spiritual. There's a lot that qualify themselves for that calling. But no, a Christian who's running the race of life with encumbrances, weights, and the past and the circumstances of the past still holding them back is an immature Christian. And the author here says that we need not to do that. We need not to go back to the basics that we've learned already, to the principles that should be the foundation of our faith. We need to be eating of the meat and not just drinking of the milk all the time. So what, there is a difference, you know, between a child in the faith and a matured Christian. And you've probably not heard this, but there is a difference between many Christians today and municipal bonds. Haven't you heard that? There's a difference between most Christians and municipal bonds. Bonds will mature, but most Christians today do not. They're always getting tossed aside by the weight that has encumbered them and the weight that's holding them back. I remember back to 1999 when Michigan was playing against Notre Dame. And Notre Dame was leading by 4 points because they scored in the last minute of the game. And I looked at my friend who was a Notre Dame fan and putting it to me that Michigan was getting beat and was going to be beat by Notre Dame. And he was putting my nose in it and letting me hear all about it. And the team member from Notre Dame who was in the end zone was celebrating a wee bit too much. And so the flag came out. And I kind of teased the Notre Dame guy. He was a lawyer, so I really let him have it. And I said to him, hey, Brian, how do you like that? 15 yards. He's like, no big deal. The kickoff occurred. Michigan got the ball on about the 40. They drove it to the other team's 40. Now they're down to the 20. And you wouldn't you know it, with seconds left in the game, Michigan won the game. Here's the reason why. Notre Dame was going to win the game, and they celebrated in the past. You got to, when you get there, you got to act like you've been there, right? And you got to remember, there's rules and principles to be applied. And if you act like a punk while you're winning the game in the end zone, you can be penalized. so you don't leave anyone behind. You think for the team, and you can't go by your past circumstances, good or bad. God doesn't assess you by what you've done, rather by what his son has done and by what you do with what his son has done for you and me. Injuries, penalties, bad plays won't end your life, but they may just disqualify you or hurt your team and family. So you lay aside the weight, the past circumstances, and you get on with it, and you forsake the circumstances of the past, and then you forget your past sin. Says in verse 1, the sin which so easily ensnares us. Sin there is, there's lots of different terms in our Bible for sin in the original language, but in this particular passage, it's harmartia, which means just missing the mark. Romans 3:23, for all have missed the mark, for all have sinned. Same word there in Romans 3 that's there in Hebrews 12:1. Sin, a small indiscretion, a small sin. It's not a transgression or a perversion. No, it's a small sin that turns into, watch this, a habit, a vice that you can't seem to get over. And you need to forget that past sin. Back in 2016, there was a lady that swam for the United States team. Her name was Katie Ledecky. And her coaches and all of her team members said, Katie is the most methodical, mechanical swimmer ever. From the time she had a coach as a little girl, he or she taught Katie how to swim so perfectly, so principled in her body that she taught, and her muscle memory was so good, her mechanics so good, that people said Katie is unbeatable because mechanically, methodically, she's just a winner. And she was made to be a winner. Did you know you were made when Jesus Christ saved you and you let him enter your heart? You were made to be a winner. He made you to be a winner, a conqueror. He wants you to prosper in life and to get over everything that's overcoming you and me. So we've got to lay aside the weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. Now, I want you to think Katie's in the good way, the affirming way. Katie's learned how to mechanically and methodically win, and she follows the principles and the procedures that will make her a winner, and you can too. But there's another winner in life that we've learned about in football. His name was Johnny Manziel. He was a good player, small guy on a big man sport. And he made it good at Texas A&M. And he was a winner, and everyone wanted to be around him. So they didn't mind that he started this little sin habit. He just missed the mark. It started in high school, little bit of the drink. Then he went to college, and because he was a winner and he could produce, even when he'd thrown them back, they just kind of let it go. But when you graduate out and you get out of the guys that can play on your level, and now you're playing on another level, listen, and Satan knows the level that the Lord wishes to take you. He's waiting for the chance to trip and trap you up. So listen, he may promote you to the next level, to where he promotes your little sin practice, and he perverts the great and grand plan that God has for you by exposing it to the public. When Johnny went to the pros and to the Cleveland Browns, he was playing at a whole nother level, a level that he couldn't handle. And so what did he do? He turned to the sin habit that had helped him through some other things. And he started throwing them back. And he started partying heavy and harder. And it became public. And then his transgression came out. You see, because way back, he started it and it was just missing the mark. But by the time that Satan had perverted it within, it had turned into a transgression in his life. Now his little missing the mark was not only hurting him, it was hurting the people around him. It hurt his fiance. It hurt his teammates. It hurt his coaches from Texas A&M and his coaches in Cleveland. People lost their jobs because of a sin habit. Your kids could lose their future because they're following in your footsteps. your teachers at school could lose their principal mattered because they thought more of you, and then you allowed certain things to happen. You started talking like the rest just to fit in with your peers. You started trying to fit in. Your life, your marriage, your finances, all of that, you just missed the mark, but you allowed it to continue. And the sin which so easily ensnares us. Remember, Katie Ledecky with the butterfly, she learned principled procedures that mechanically, methodically made her to be a winner. And Christ has made you that way. But Satan tempts you. The flesh is weak, and the world encompasses you and wants to conform you to fit in. It's so easy to fall into the trap of sin and just say, it's just a small thing. And it is. But it gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and then it overcomes you. Sin is like a penalty in football, like the Russian doping scam of the 2016 Paralympic Games. Just a few of their athletes on that Paralympic Russian team doped up, but the whole team was disqualified because some didn't wish to follow the rules. You can disqualify not only yourself, but your team because you allow unprincipled practices to go on in your life. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 6:18, we should flee immorality. Sexual sin is the only sin that you and I can commit that comes back. It's a sin against our own bodies. Then Paul said to Timothy in 2 Timothy 2:22, he said, flee youthful lust. And James said in James 4:7, resist the devil and he will flee from you. You can do this. You can do this. You say, Pastor, you don't know how deep I'm in it. I know I don't. But God does, and he will make a way. He will make a way. He has provided you with the Holy Spirit, the helper, the counselor, the encourager. He will enable you to get away from it when you're empowered in and through him. You could be the one player to take the entire team down. But you could also be the one player on your home, in your home, on your team that brings the whole team up like Katie Ledecky. You can either be a Katie or you can be a Johnny. Which do you choose to be? And God could make you robotic, but he doesn't. He made you in his image, so it's your choice. 1 Corinthians 9:24, do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may obtain it. Failure is never final as long as there's Christ. So you focus also, thirdly, focus on Christ. The New King James Version say, looking unto Jesus. The NIV says, fix your eyes on Christ. The New American Standard says, fixing your eyes on Jesus. The meaning is all the same. The focus must be and should be kept only on Christ. He is the one who forsook everything so that you and I could have all that he has. Don't focus on the crowd. I remember the one race that Michael Phelps got in that he lost by just less than a second. Do you remember that? They had a picture of it on the internet. And it was because he looked to the competitor beside him instead of focusing on the finish line. He looked to see where the competitor was. And in that less than a second, he lost that race. Man, just shaving by a hair, you may lose the prize if you don't keep your eyes focused on Christ. Don't focus on the crowd. Remember, you need to focus on the audience of one. Don't focus on the competition like Michael Phelps, and don't focus on your circumstances. Your circumstances. Friday, I had a gentleman who put up fencing for us when we first moved here to town. I asked Brian to come back to our house and fix some of our wood fence. And while Brian was fixing some of my fence, I went out behind the house and was cutting down this kudzu that comes up. If you're the person that brought kudzu from the Asian Pacific to Alabama, I curse you. What's wrong with you? That stuff grows everywhere. I was cutting it. I was sweating profusely. It was terrible. I was back there saying, oh, I hate kudzu, and I hate all these branches and trees growing up in between the two properties, and my neighbor comes out of his house. He had forgotten that when we first met, I told him that I was a minister. It's probably a good thing. So he was very colorful in his language and alarmingly, wonderfully teaching me new things that I had never heard before, and grammatical sentence structure. I was getting fed up, and I know you all don't know me that well, but I can get fed up, and I was getting madder and madder. Finally, I had had enough, and I turned to him, and I called him by his name, and I said, I've had enough. And he said, what have you had? Did you not recall that I told you I was a minister? Yeah, I was going to ask you what kind of a job you have. And I said, well, I'm a minister. He said, well, what do you do during the week? That's always the response. It's funny. So he was making me madder by the moment. And I thought, man, there's only one way. And now the workers that have come with Brian are listening to me as I talk to my neighbor. And he's embarrassed because he's looking at his watch now because he wants to get away from me because I'm a minister. And I asked him, do you go to church? What's your background? Yeah, I'm a Catholic. And I'm like, I love Catholics. You didn't learn that language in the Catholic Church, did you? Well, I didn't mean anything by it. I haven't offended you. I just looked at him. I started going through Way of the Master. So I called him by his name, and I, have you ever lied? No. Would you tell me something? How does a man get to heaven? How does a woman get to heaven? How does a young boy, young girl get to heaven? Now listen to me. He focused on his circumstances. Oh, I know you're Baptist. You know, I know. And I'm like, no, you think when we get to heaven, God's going to care what we call ourselves here? That doesn't even, man, I love you, and you're a Catholic, and I'm a Baptist. It doesn't matter. That doesn't matter at all. So now he's taken back by that because he's an older guy. I said to him, have you ever lied? No, I've never lied. I would have said, well, you just told your first, but I thought, I'm not going to. We'll get to something. And he said, I've never lusted after another woman. I'm like, never? Well, back before I, you know, got baptized and saved. I'm like, oh, you're saved. Yeah, I was baptized when I was a boy. So you've not sinned since you're a boy? Yeah. I'm like, you're a better man than me. I started quoting him scripture, and he's like, you're learned in the Bible, aren't you? And I said, not really. I just know a few scriptures, and if you give me one more minute, Gary, I can tell you how you can for sure know that you'll spend eternity in heaven. Oh, I've already said that prayer. We've got a book of prayers. And I'm like, I know. I've got a lot of good Catholic friends. Listen, I never disparage all of his upbringing, all of his past circumstances, all of his past, all of the things that he had gone through. Never disparage. You can't win much with that. But then he let me in the door, and listen to what he did. He took God's holy name in vain. And I said to him, you know, Gary, if my daughter were standing here and you said Allah's name, she would be offended because she's gone halfway around the world to minister to Muslims. And Allah's name to them is holy. You wouldn't in America even take Allah's name in vain here because they might cut our head off as infidels. But yet, you and I, Catholic and Baptist, folks, we've gotten acclimated to just taking God's holy name. I didn't take God's name. I'm like, Gary, you took the holy name of God profanely. You wouldn't say, oh, my Steve Anthony. Well, no, I wouldn't. And I'm like, you've never taken your name in vain, have you? No, I wouldn't. You took God's name. It didn't take me telling him he was a liar or he was Catholic or that he was a lustful person or that he was proud and arrogant. It didn't take any. He sinned right there because we're so proficient at it in America. I said, Gary, you and I sin. All of us are sinners and we fall short of the glory of God. And within 5 minutes, that man's got tears running down his eyes. What do I need to do? What do I need to do? So I told him. I threw a life preserver to Gary, and he strapped it on and said the prayer. Now, does he mean it? I told him I wouldn't say the prayer with him if he didn't read the Gospel of John every day for the next month, because I want him to know what he's learned in a Baptist church or a Catholic church won't do it. What the Word of God says will do it. And you got to fix your focus on Jesus Christ. He is the one who, for the joy set before him, endured the cross, despising its shame. For Steve and Gary and you and all of us in this room, you've got to focus on Christ. If you focus on the Baptist faith or the Catholic faith, if you focus on your grandparents' faith or your mama or your daddy's faith, you're focusing your fix on the wrong person. That will always get you into trouble. The watermark is Jesus Christ, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. He could have called 10,000 angels. He could have got off that cross, but he didn't. His mission was you and me. Our names were written on the palms of his hands. He wanted to fulfill his purpose, his plan in his life, and that means naked on the cross, the God of glory, the creator of all, he gave himself for you and me. So we should focus our eyes on the finish line of Jesus Christ, and we should endure all that he would have us to endure. And he knows just how much pain it will take to bring gain for you and for your loved ones. He knows exactly where to place you in the midst of a test, on a triumph hill, in the midst of a painful situation, to get you so uncomfortable that you'll only fix your focus on him and say, I can't do this anymore. And he's like, good, let's do this together. And then he gives you exactly what you need for you to cross the finish line. And that is the goal of the Christian matured walk, to run across that line. Now, I've got 7 other things I want to give you out of this text, but I can't for sake of time. But what I want to do, I want to issue a plea that I did to my friend Gary yesterday. I just want to say, man, if your focus has been on your circumstances, if your focus has been on the crowd, and you're trying to please others, or you're trying to please yourself, you're not focused on Christ. You're not fixed on the person who will save you from your sin and set you free from your past and unlock and unload all the encumbrances and the weight that's holding you back, the guilt, the shame, the burdens, the losses. He wants to set you free so that you can run with endurance the race set before you and me and cross the finish line. Hear the words, well done, good and faithful. Enter now into the joy of the Lord. Oh, my friends, I don't understand this, but Jude 24 says, now to him, Christ, who is able, he is able to seal you and to present you before God the Father without any imperfections, blotless, sinless. How can Steve Anthony stand before God the Father without sin and transgression? Not on my record. Because Jesus Christ gives me the wreath of the winner and the robe of righteousness that covers me from the penalty of my own sins. And he says to his Father, not by works of righteousness which Steve has done, but by my grace, I saved him and set him free. Wouldn't you like to be set free today? Wouldn't you like to invite him into your heart today? Wouldn't you like to set a new standard in your life and to run free and endure to the end? I know you would. Bow your heads with me and close your eyes. God, I'm praying.